Hello, my name's Nick Thody. I'm the head of knowledge at Osborne Clark, and I'm joined today by Catherine Hammon, our digital revolution knowledge lawyer, and we're going to discuss various aspects of the blockchain or blockchain. Catherine, thanks for coming along. Let's start at the very beginning for people like me who don't know really anything about this. Just briefly, what is the blockchain?
So blockchain is essentially a software and data structure. It's a new technology of how to record data, how to structure that data. It is recorded in such a way using encryption so that it's locked down, so that the data is very, very secure and can't be tampered with. It's incredibly difficult to tamper with it. One of the other defining characteristics usually is that the data is managed in such a way that you don't have a single central authority deciding what goes onto the blockchain. The system, the network, all the participants together decide what goes onto the blockchain. Now, also, another key element of it is that because there's no single central authority, that means there's no single definitive version of the blockchain. All the people involved in the system have an equally valid, equally complete, equally reliable copy of the blockchain. So one of the other ways that it's sometimes described is as distributed ledger technology. Distributed refers to the fact, this decentralization fact, this fact that you haven't got a central authority in the middle of everything, all of the network is involved. Ledger is the database, like an accounting ledger. Everybody's got a copy of it, it's equally valid. So that's essentially the key elements.
Okay, so it's a decentralized ledger with no central authority. I can see that it would be very appealing to the libertarian community. And just on that, where did the blockchain come from? Because certainly 10 years ago, I'm pretty sure I hadn't heard of it, and then suddenly it was everywhere.
Yeah, so you're quite right with your 10 years. The first blockchain, as we know it now, was created by Bitcoin, is the Bitcoin system. Bitcoin was proposed in a paper which was published in October 2008 at the absolute height of the financial crisis. The first ever Bitcoin was created in January 2009, and the structure was invented by somebody or some people under the pseudonym of Satoshi Nakamoto. Nobody knows who this person or these people are. And it was very much a reaction to the financial crisis. And what they wanted to do was create a way of transferring value which didn't need a bank in the middle.
And there isn't a fiat currency, I guess, as well. And of course, various people have been exposed as supposedly Mr. Nakamoto, but we're still no closer to understanding exactly who or whom that was. Now, you said earlier that the data is locked down, the crucial aspect of blockchain. Can you explain a bit more about how that locking down is done?
Yeah, so the locking down is done with something called hashing. Hashing is a form of encryption. It's not encryption in the sense of secret communications or transferring data in a secret way. It's a way of turning data into a sequence of numbers and letters, which you can then use for different purposes. So what you do with the Bitcoin system, you take information, you take the data, and each piece of data is then turned into a hash. Now, the hash will always, the same piece of data will always generate the same hash. A slightly different piece of data, so delete a word, add a new page of data, etc., a slightly different piece of data or a different piece of data will generate a completely different hash. And you can't predict from one piece of data to the next how the hash will change, and also you can't reverse engineer from the hash back to the original data. So what happens is, imagine, so the easiest way to describe this is a tournament structure. So you start off with lots of pieces of data which are like your original players in the tournament. You hash each one, and then you hash two hashes together, and then you hash two hashes together, and you hash. So just like your tournament, you end up with a single hash, a single winner at the end of the structure. And remember, the whole network can see that this is going on. It's a public process. Bitcoin is a public network. And any slight change to any one of those pieces of data will change the hash, and that change will flow through the system so that the hash at the end is changed. So you lock it down using these hashes because it creates complete transparency over any change in the underlying data. The network can see it, can see that there's been some change.
So you've explained how hashing is used to lock down the data. How then do a line of blocks get put into a chain, blockchain?
Yeah. So you finished your hashing process and you've ended up with a single hash which represents a whole set of data. You take that piece of information, you take the date and time, you give it a date and time stamp, and there's a couple of other bits of information, and you then hash those together, and what you end up with is a block header hash. So you end up with a hash which represents all of the information, all of the data, plus the time, plus a couple of other bits of information, and you create a block header. Now, the previous block has also got a block header, and I mentioned there's a couple of other bits of data. One of those other bits of data that you include in the hash for your new block is the hash header from the old block. So you take that hash, you add it in, so that creates a link back to the previous block, and you create your new block header hash. The next block comes along, you take the block header hash and you include that in the final hash for that block. So you can see that you end up with a sequence. Each block is mathematically attached to the one before it, and that's how the chain is created.
Okay, so that's the blockchain as an entity. So bringing it on to kind of more practical application away from the theory that underlay that famous white paper, how does mining, Bitcoin mining, fit into all of that? Because I think if there's one thing that everyone has heard of in connection with blockchain, it's the mining of Bitcoin, which always sounds quite fun. Yeah.
Quite fun. So Bitcoin mining is the protocol for Bitcoin specifically, by which the network agrees to add a block. Now, a more generic way of expressing it is the consensus mechanism. It's the consensus mechanism by which the system agrees that a new block should be added. Now, I've explained that that's done by linking the block hashes, et cetera, et cetera. For Bitcoin specifically, the rule is that the miners are looking for, so I mentioned the block hash of the previous block, the final hash from that sequence of data, the date and timestamp. Now, the fourth element that goes into the block header hash is a number which the Bitcoin miners have to find. They don't know what that number is, they have to find it. Now, I said before that you hash data together and you end up with a string. The rule for Bitcoin is that the block header hash has to begin, at the moment it changes, at the moment it has to begin with 18 zeros. Now, what the miners have to do is to find a random number which creates a hash which begins with 18 zeros. Remember, we can't predict what the hash is going to look like. It could be any combination of numbers and letters, so it could have as many zeros at the beginning. There isn't a right answer to this. It just has to be a hash with 18 zeros at the front. Now, what's the random number? This is a bit like, it's called proof of work, and it's often talked about as a mathematical challenge. It's not a mathematical challenge in the sense that it's conceptually difficult to find the answer. It's not like proving a theorem, something like that, which it may never be done. It can take decades to work out the answer. It's not that kind of challenge, it's not that kind of difficulty. It's difficult in the same sense that cracking a safe code is difficult. So if you keep going, if you've got a four-number lock and you don't know what the number is, if you start at 00001, 2, 3, you'll get there. It's not difficult in the sense that it's conceptually difficult. It's difficult because it takes a lot of power and crunching to get there. So proof of work for Bitcoin is the same sort of thing. You have to find a magic number, a random number, which when you add it to the blockchain header for the previous block, the final hash to the sequence of data, the date and timestamp, when you add in this secret number, this magic number, this random number, it throws out a hash with 18 zeros at the front. Now that process, that proof of work process, that hunting for the number, is what the Bitcoin miners are doing. Once you arrive at that number, you lock that block back to the previous one. Now, I called it a consensus mechanism. There's no consensus in the traditional sense of a meeting of the minds, but you can infer the consensus. You can assume it's there because the miners then move on from working on that block and start to work on the next one. So that's what mining is. Now, why do we call it mining? That still doesn't make a connection to that word. The reward for that process, for successfully finding a number which generates the right kind of hash, the reward is brand new, freshly minted Bitcoin. At the moment, it's 12.5 brand new Bitcoin, and which when you think each Bitcoin's worth thousands, that's a good sum. So it's called mining because it's a bit like digging up fresh gold from the earth. You're creating new Bitcoin by the process of mining.
So you're kind of hitting the algorithmic or computer pay dirt, so to speak.
Exactly.
Okay, and it takes up quite a lot of energy, I think.
Yes, it does. So Mark Carney, the Governor of England, recently quoted a statistic that Bitcoin mining consumption of energy at the moment is roughly twice the consumption of Scotland. It takes a huge amount of energy. And that's because, firstly, the Bitcoin mining process these days is done with very custom-built computers, computer processing power. It uses brute force computer power, brute force computer processing. So it needs a lot of energy, A, for the computers themselves, and B, to cool them down, because they generate a lot of heat.
Okay, so good luck, good for you if you're in Iceland and next to a hydroelectric electricity plant, I guess. So I've mined and got my Bitcoin. If I want to transfer it to someone else, i.e. start it to have characteristics of, say, a currency, how do I actually go around transferring it?
So this is the other big element of the Bitcoin system. We've talked about how you lock down the data, how you mine it, et cetera, how you confirm it. The other element, of course, as you say, is that Bitcoin was created as a way of transferring value. Now, there are two things you want to know if you're going to transfer value to someone. You want to know, firstly, that they are who they say they are, and you want to know, secondly, that they're good for the money. So the first one, are they who they say they are? The way that I sort of access my Bitcoin as a miner, I've just got some fresh new Bitcoin, I want to spend it. I have two different keys. Again, this is a form of encryption, of cryptography, not secure communications, cryptography for a different purpose. I have two keys. I have a private key, which only I know, and I have a public key, which everybody knows. You know it, the whole of the network knows it. It's not confidential in any way. Nobody knows my private key, but the two keys are mathematically linked. So you can use the public key to check if the private key was used. So if I want to transfer Bitcoin to you, you've got my public key. The first thing you want to do is to check I am who I say I am, and you can see that because you can use my public key to check that it's the private key involved in transferring the Bitcoin to you.
How does the recipient know that you own those actual Bitcoin?
Yeah, so again, these keys are important again for this aspect. So this is how you check that I'm good for the money, yeah. Essentially. So for lawyers, this is quite a simple concept, actually. The way that Bitcoin works is a bit like an old-fashioned land law root of title in unregistered land. You need the chain of title. For land law, we like to see the sequence of transfers going back at least 30 years. Bitcoin is a bit like that. It's one of those nice juxtapositions of very old ideas being used in a very new way. So essentially, when I transfer my Bitcoin to you, in the information that I broadcast to the network about I'm sending some to you, I include where I got the Bitcoin from. And I take that transaction data, including my source information, and I combine it with my private key to create a digital signature around that transaction, which you can check is me because you've got my public key. Now, those source transactions, which is how I receive the data, of course, they'll be locked onto the blockchain, so everyone can see them and everyone can verify them. And those transactions themselves will have included their source transactions. And so you can see that you can actually, with a Bitcoin transfer, you can follow it all the way back, potentially back to the moment that it was created, that the Bitcoin was originally mined. So you have that sequence. So you can see that I'm good. You can see that I'm good for the money because you can follow it right back to when it was created.
Okay, that's useful. Thanks. And then, I think one thing people you often hear is blockchain and Bitcoin being elided as concepts. But if I want to use a blockchain structure, that doesn't have to involve replicating or using Bitcoin, does it?
No, exactly. Now, Bitcoin is the longest established. It was the first blockchain structure. It's a public one. It's probably the one that's the best understood and the most information is available about. So when you're explaining blockchain, it usually gets explained by reference to Bitcoin, simply because you can explain the whole thing and understand it. But you're quite right. You don't have to replicate Bitcoin in order to have blockchain. And what helps in this scenario is to think about what are the different elements of this kind of structure. So we've got the data layer, that's locking down the data using the hashing, etc. We've got the consensus layer, how do we agree to add the block. We've got the particularities of the system, so Bitcoin is all about value transfer, so you've got these ideas of the chain of value, the chain of ownership of this value, etc. And then we've got the access rules, how do you get into the system, public keys, private keys, all that sort of thing. Now, each of those elements of the stack drive different characteristics of the blockchain structure. So locking down the data, that's driven by the data layer. Now, if you don't care about the lockdown data, you probably don't need a blockchain structure. The consensus mechanism is what drives the decentralization. So you don't have a central authority saying, yes, he is good for the money, he is transferring it. You don't have that kind of confirmation as you do in financial transactions normally. You have the consensus mechanism. If you don't actually care about decentralization, you don't need to have that element, but that's what drives it. If decentralization is what you need, that's the bit that you really need to go with the lockdown data. You can have public systems, you can have private systems, permissioned, permissionless blockchains. So that will drive how you access the system, how you run the keys system, et cetera, et cetera. And it can also play into the consensus mechanism, because if you've got a private system, it doesn't have quite so many people involved. You can have a simpler consensus mechanism, et cetera. So there's lots of variations on all of this. In fact, this, when people try to define blockchain, you see very many different variations. There's no standard definition of blockchain, although people are working on it. And about the only thing that you can consistently say that all blockchain structures have is the lockdown data element, because after that, everything else changes and it just depends on what you want out of it. The consensus mechanism in particular, we talked about Bitcoin mining and how it uses a vast amount of energy. There are quite a lot of alternatives to that. Mining is the best known one because it goes with Bitcoin, and most of the other well-known cryptocurrencies use something similar. There's an alternative to proof of work, which is called proof of stake, which is essentially a requirement that in order to confirm transactions, you have to have skin in the game, as it were. You have to be holding some of the cryptocurrency. The more cryptocurrency you hold, the more likely you are to be selected to confirm one of the transactions, etc. And in some of the systems, if you game the system, if you behave badly, if you start to behave in a way which isn't appropriate, then they can actually sort of fine you by taking some of your stake away. And then there's also much simpler systems which use a more traditional form of consensus. So the block will be added if 2/3 of the network confirm that they agree with the block being added. So you can have much, much simpler systems.
Okay. So there's a lot of
variation.
The basic structure. And a final question for this segment, which I think puzzles a lot of people, who, certainly including me, who aren't experts in this field at all. But if the blockchain is so secure, why do we hear about it being hacked so much? Because that's been a particular feature of news stories around this area in the past couple of years, starting with the sort of Mt. Gox incident and then a few others since then. You know, you've just spent quite a long time explaining how secure it is. So how is it hacked, or is it not hacked?
No, it is hacked. It's not the blockchain itself which gets hacked. It's incredibly difficult to attack the blockchain itself, because it's visible, because it's locked down, because one tiny change to the data and the whole thing feeds through, et cetera, et cetera. It's not the blockchain itself which gets hacked, it's the access points which get hacked. So if you hold Bitcoin and I steal your private key, that Bitcoin essentially is mine. It's like a bearer share. If it's in my hands, it's mine. Cool. I've got it. So people's Bitcoin wallets which hold their keys, they can get hacked and then you can access them. Sometimes that's done with a straightforward hack and go in and thieve it. Sometimes it's done with phishing. You accidentally or you mistakenly give the information about your private key to someone who isn't who you thought they were, phishing. Also, the exchanges have been the subject of hacks. So if I have Bitcoin and I want to turn it back into real money, I essentially sell it on an exchange for real money. Someone buys my Bitcoin and give me traditional currency for it. And so those exchanges can be hacked. And at that point, it's the actual money itself, the traditional money, which gets stolen and not the Bitcoin, etc. And then we haven't really talked about them, but ICOs, initial coin offerings, which is where new coin is created. One of the other classic hacks is to divert the money coming in to buy the new cryptocurrency off to the hacker's account rather than it going to the place it was intended to go to. So there's lots of different ways, but it's about hacking the access points into the system and not hacking the actual blockchain itself.
Okay, no, I get it. But won't be doing it. great. For now, Catherine, on blockchain, thank you very much.
Thank you.